Good morning, students. This is our new section of biology class. Today, we are going to start with a new topic. The name of the topic is Cell Structure and Function. This chapter comes in your Unit 3. And the number of the chapter is chapter number 8. So let us see. The title itself says the structure and function. What is structure? That means the making of the cell and its function. What are the different functions that we are going to study? So everybody knows that a living being is made of number of cells. But from where does this cell come? Have you any idea? You must be having some idea because you have already learned this in your previous classes about the cell. So this chapter will not be very difficult for you to understand because you have already read something about this chapter. Now let us see what is cell. So we will start. I have noted down few of the points, important points, which you are going to study. Now, do you know biology is the study of living organisms? Everybody knows why do we study biology? Bio, as you know, the word itself tells, bio means life and logy means science. So the science of life is known as biology. So let us see. Biology is the study of living organisms. Whatever thing on this earth is living comes under biology. Maybe it is a unicellular organism, a multicellular organism, or a plant, whatever it may be. Everything comes under the heading biology. So you have followed. What is biology? Study of living organism is known as biology. Now, from initial stage, we will see what happened. How the scientist found out what is life, how it starts. It must have been taken millions of years ago when the cell must have come into being. So detailed study has brought out diversity. And as years passed by, scientists studied about the biological system or the biology of cells or the details of cells, and gradually they came to know about the various aspects of the cells. That's why it is said detailed study has brought out the diversity. Diversity means the variation, the different types of cells. That means every cell is made for a purpose. Like our brain cells, they are used in the brain, that is called the neurons. They are used for the memory, for the messages to pass. In the same way, we have different organs in our body and they have different types of cells. They do their own work and they form the organ system. Now we will see how the cell develops or grows. First, when the body is taking shape, our body starts with a single cell. Single cell will now multiply. So the cell grows through cell division. One cell will be divided into 2, then into 4, then into 8, and so on. So cell grows from one single cell to millions and millions of cells that are present in our body. So the next point, cell study has revealed the mystery behind cellular organisms. As the scientists started studying about the cells, they came to know about the various mysteries of the cells, that is how they are made, how they develop, and how they organize in the body. It enables us to describe various processes. Now these cells, every cell, they work together for the various processes that take place in our body. All the cells are united to work for us, for the maintenance, for the well-being of our body. Not a single cell will go out of the way and will say, oh, today I'm not going to work because I'm too tired. They will not say that. They will continuously work until their day comes to an end. Cells help in forming tissues, organs, systems. So every single cell has its own duty to perform. A group of cells will come together and form a tissue. A tissue or a group of tissue will again come together and form organ system. You must be knowing that we have several systems in our body, like the digestive system, like the excretory system. These type of systems, how they are formed, each single cell will come together, they'll form a tissue, and then later on they form the organ. In this way, they perform their duties. The organic compound present in the cell. Now this cell is, maybe it is very easy to pronounce the word cell, but it is the most complicated organ of our system of our body, or the cell is quite complicated because it is made out of different types of compounds present in them, the different chemicals that is required. So this organic compound present in the cell, there are many organic compounds, chemicals that help in the building of the cell. Now, how they help in physiological process? As you know, there are many, many processes going on continuously in our body. So these cells, they help in performing these physiological processes in our body. The most important thing that you know is the digestive system. The digestive system is totally a chemical system, or it, and in this process, the food that you take in from morning to night undergoes various processes so that they can be absorbed by the body for the fulfillment of the nourishment of our body. They provide us with nutrition, they provide us with vitamins, they provide us with minerals, they provide us with the different types of hormones through the secretory glands. So the physiological processes of digestion, then comes the absorption, When we consume some food, first they are digested, later on they are absorbed by the body. Absorption is very, very important. If absorption does not take place, then what is the use of eating food? Because all food will go in waste. So the body absorbs the required nutrients, the vitamins, the minerals, and then what is left as waste material is excreted through our body. That means they are removed through our body. And all these physiological processes need the help of the cell. So the cell is so important that even a single cell of our body is not working, then there will be problem with the digestion, absorption and excretion of the body. Then cell is also required for the memory. Whatever we think, we remember, we say are done by the neural cells that are present in the brain. So cells are very important for the memory also. If even a single cell is not working in your brain, then your brain cannot function properly. They also help in the defense mechanism. What is defense mechanism? Defense, that means the cell protects us from various types of diseases. So defense of our body is required. They are very important because if our body is not defended from the external things like bacteria, viruses, then we may fall sick and our body may not work properly. So have you followed? Since biology is the study of living organisms, and that living organism is known as the cell, and cells can do so many functions in our body. Now let us further see what happens. What is the molecular basis of all living organisms? What is molecular basis? That means the compounds, the chemicals that are required by the body, small amount. We don't need liters of chemicals, only a little amount, a microscopic amount of chemicals are required. That's why they say the molecular basis of all living organisms. We will further learn it in detail about the molecular basis of all living organisms. Now we'll come to the next point, the abnormal process that occurs during a disease condition. What is this? When we fall sick, we feel something uneasy in our body. Maybe our head is aching, maybe our stomach is aching, maybe our whole body is aching. Why? Because the cells that are present or are required for the normal activity of our body must have not in proper way. Maybe they are not working in the proper way. That's why we fall ill. Diseases occur when there is some problem in the cells, and therefore we fall ill. We come across various types of diseases, maybe due to the attack of the virus, maybe due to attack of the bacteria. And from where does these bacteria, virus enter? Through the food, through the water, through the air, that is around us. We must have taken some bad food, eaten some stale food, some impure water, and therefore this enters our body and the diseases take place. And how do we come to know that we are sick? Because our body is not functioning properly and we get some ailments. The physicochemical approach. This is the next point. What is it? The physicochemical approach to study and understand living organisms is called reductionist biology. What is this physicochemical? Physicochemical means combination of physics and chemistry. When we study biology, we not only study biology, we also study physics, we also study chemistry, because we have to know about the physics part of the body, the equilibrium and whatever you learn from the physics, the chemical part of the all our food that we take, what type of chemicals we get from our food. So physicochemical, we have to study both the things, physics as well as chemistry, to know more about the living organism. The living organism is made entirely of physics, chemistry, and then biology is formed. And this is called reductionist biology. Both the subjects are combined together, and then we say that this is reductionist biology. Next comes, the technique of physics and chemistry are applied to understand biology. As I told you before, that physics is very important, chemistry is very important to learn biology. So until you come to know more about physics, more about chemistry, only then you can understand something about biology. So biology is quite a complex subject. You have to first know the technique of physics, chemistry, which you will apply in the biology to understand the living cell. So I hope you have followed all these 12 points about the study of living organism of the biology. Now, then we will move to the next subtopic of your book, and that topic is the unit of life. What is this unit of life? Unit, as all of you know, is a single thing, single digit or the single cell. This is called unit of life. So let us see the first point in this, the difference between a living and a non-living thing. Everybody knows that this entire universe is made out of living and non-living things. What is living thing? A thing that contains self is known as living, and that thing which do not have life is known as non-living thing. So in this vast universe, there are so many living and non-living things which we are going to study later on. Now let us see, what is the basic unit of life? Everybody knows the basic unit of our life is a cell. If we don't have a cell in our body, we are not called living things. The cell is only the thing which gives life to our body. You can see many different idols during the festival season. They look so lively, as if they are going to just talk to you. But they don't talk. Why? Because they don't have the basic unit of life, and that is cell. Those idols don't have cell in their body. That's why they are called non-living things. So the basic unit of life is cell, Remember this point. The cell is all living organisms. Every living organism, maybe it is a unicellular, a multicellular, a plant, everything has cell. Without cell, nothing can be called as unit of living. Or we cannot say that this chair or bench on which you are sitting today is a non-living thing. Why? Because it does not have a cell in it. That's why we call this chair and a table a non-living thing. But we cannot call ourselves a non-living thing. Why? Because our body contains several thousand million billion cells. We are made out of billions of cells. And that's why we are known as living things. All organisms are composed of cells. As I already told you, we, the human beings, the plants, the animals, the insects, the birds, everybody is made out of millions of cells. So you follow? The basic unit of life is what? It is the cell. The cell is the most important thing for a living being. Now we will see what is unicellular and what is multicellular. Unicellular, you must have already studied in your lower classes about the unicellular living things. Can you give me an example? Yes. Very good. It is the amoeba, that is a unicellular living thing that everybody has studied from their lower class. So you know, amoeba has only one single cell. And when this single cell divides into how many divisions? Two. They are known as daughter cells. They are not called brother and sister because one single cell gives rise to two cells and they are known as daughter cells. So unicellular means an organism having only one cell with a nucleus, and the example is amoeba. The best example of a unicellular living thing is amoeba. Now multicellular. What is multicellular? Multi, the word multi itself will describe what it is. That means it has millions and millions of cells. Like we human beings, plants, animals, we are made out of many, many, many cells. That's why we are known as multicellular. Now, what do you think? Well, these unicellular things cannot eat, cannot drink, cannot move. No, they can move. They take in food. There is digestion. There is absorption. There is secretion. There is excretion. All the process takes place in this unicellular amoeba also. Unicellular organisms are capable of independent existence. Independent existence means they can move by themselves. They can eat their food by themselves. They can excrete by themselves. They move and they catch their food. And that's why they are called independent existence, performing all the essential functions of life. Whatever essential function we perform in our life, like digestion, absorption, excretion, they also do the same thing. Example, I already explained to you digestion, absorption, excretion, reproduction. They even reproduce. That their reproduction is known as asexual reproduction, where they do not need another partner for reproduction. They can reproduce by themselves, which is known as cell division, and thus a single amoeba or the unicellular amoeba can be divided into 2 cells, 4 cells, 8 cells. In this way, you have come to know the unicellular living organism. They can do all the functions by themselves. Now, we will see in our next video the multicellular organisms. You know there are 2 types of cells, prokaryotic and eukaryotic. We will learn more about prokaryotic and eukaryotic in the next video that you will see very recently. Now, so let us come to this topic. Let us come to an end to this topic. I hope you have followed it and you will revise it. So let us say bye for today and thank you for listening to this part of the video. We will come and see what is there in the next part of the video. Today, we are going to see the structure of the cell. Yesterday, we had seen that how a cell is the basic unit of life. A single cell is the basic unit of life. Now, today we will see the structure or the diagram of the cell. First, we are going to see what is a prokaryote cell. There are 2 types of cells. One is prokaryote and one is eukaryote. So, prokaryote cell, the diagram you can see on the board. What is prokaryote cell? In this cell, there is no clear defined nucleus. The nucleus is not clearly defined. You can see this portion is the nucleus where you cannot separate it out, or you cannot understand whether it is having a nucleus, anything. It is just in a haphazard manner. So, in prokaryotic cell, there is no clearly defined nucleus. This you can find in bacteria and blue-green algae. This type of prokaryote cell is found in bacteria and blue-green algae. Now we will see what this structure has. This is the cell wall. This is the structure of the prokaryote cell having a cell wall. Then this is the entire capsule of the prokaryote cell. You can see the capsule. Then you can see the cytoplasm, that is the inside of the cell where cytoplasm occurs. These small things are the ribosomes, which you will read when you get the notes. Now, this is the plasma membrane. So, this is the capsule, the entire cell. Here the plasma membrane, then the cell walls, the cytoplasm, the ribosome. This is the ribosome. Then comes the plastid. This is the plasmid, and this is the long tail or the flagellum. What is this flagellum? In small bacteria, you can see the flagellum or the cilia. These are those things which help the bacteria to move. Bacteria is a living thing, that's why it has to move from one place to another. But these cells, they don't have legs to move. So they move by the flagellum. Flagellum is that thing which helps the bacteria to move. They also have small hair-like structures called the pili. So this is the pili. You can see the hair-like structure. This also helps in movement. So you have followed a prokaryotic cell which has no well-defined nucleus. It is found in bacteria and blue-green algae. This is the plasma membrane. This is the total capsule, the cell wall, the cytoplasm, the ribosomes, the flagellum, the nucleus, which is not at all well-defined, and the pili. So you got the structure of the prokaryotic cell. Now we will come to the eukaryotic cell. There are two types of cells. One, prokaryotic, which is found in lower animal life, bacteria and blue-green algae. But eukaryotic cell is a well-defined cell. Well-defined means you can see all the parts very clearly. That's why it is known as well-defined. They have the nucleus. You can see it clearly. This is the nucleus. Whereas in prokaryote, you cannot see the nucleus properly. But in eukaryote, you can see the nucleus, the entire cell. And here, it is found in protists, plants, and animals and fungi. You can find this cell in protists, plants, animals and fungi. So now we will see what are the important parts of this cell. You must have already read about it and seen the cell in your earlier classes. This is the total cell or the plasma membrane, that is the outer covering. You can see the plasma membrane. Then this is mitochondria. You are well aware what is a mitochondria. Mitochondria is the powerhouse of the cell, which gives us energy. So this is the mitochondria. Then you have endoplasmic reticulum. There are two types of endoplasmic reticulum. This is endoplasmic reticulum, which is smooth in nature. You can see they are smooth, having no rough structure. This is endoplasmic reticulum having a rough structure. This is the rough structure you can see. So the smooth endoplasmic reticulum or ER, and here I've written smooth endoplasmic reticulum, you can see. And this is the endoplasmic reticulum, rough. The structure is not even. That's why it is known as rough. Then you have vacuoles. What are vacuoles? Vacuoles are small holes. So they are full of air or water. These are vacuoles. You have the lysosome, the Golgi body. So this is the cell structure or the eukaryote cell, which is present in higher animals, plants, fungi and protists. Why we have this structure in higher animals? Because the nucleus is well defined in this structure. Therefore it is called eukaryotic cell. So we have two types of cells, prokaryotic cells and eukaryotic cells. Now in this you have the main part, the mitochondria, the smooth and endoplasmic reticulum, the rough endoplasmic reticulum. This is the nucleus, which is well defined, the vacuoles, the lysosomes, the Golgi body, and this is the entire plasma membrane. So in this chapter we have seen what is biology, what is the unit of life. So the basic unit of life is cell, from where our life starts. Then there are two kinds of cells, that is prokaryotic and eukaryotic. So in this chapter we have seen all the important parts of the cell, that is prokaryote and eukaryote. I hope students you have followed the structure of the cells very well. Now you sit and practice both the cells, and you first of all you should learn all the labeling and do label the cells properly. You will get good marks even though you have not well in the theory. You can obtain marks from the diagram itself, because diagrams or the pictures show more. So I hope you have followed it and you will study the cell structure of this animal and plant. So thank you for today. Stay home, stay safe.